Okay, now we're on YouTube, so we're got to be PG. Hey, John, we haven't seen you in a while.
Yeah, it's, I don't know. I haven't made it back to Pennsylvania for a while. Yes,
you're still in New Mexico?
Yes. Even though my background is in Utah, it's been cloudless here for I can't even tell you how many days in a row. The only problem is the moon is still pretty bright, so I've been doing some lunar observing. Last night I was looking at a crater on the full moon. I think it's called a Burgess A or something like that. I might not have said that right. But it's yesterday when I looked, or 2 days ago when I looked, it was nothing interesting. Yesterday when the moon was full, it was a wonderful fried egg, bright in the middle, with the whole kind of bright region around that circle, and then a bunch of brilliant rays coming out of it. What a difference one day makes when you're looking at things on the moon. I was looking at the Marius Hills, which is another feature. It's a very region with a lot of tiny looking volcanoes. What a difference. One day you see them and the next day you don't see them at all.
Hey, Jeremy.
Hey, Harold.
Jeremy, okay, I can share screen. Okay, I just want to make sure.
All right, YouTube is live. We should be good to go.
Okay.
You want me to make you a co-host?
Yeah, that's a good idea.
All right. All right, so Brian's also a co-host.
All right, and then one of us should monitor YouTube.
Yeah, I've got it up in the second window.
Okay, cool. Just make sure you mute it, otherwise you'll drive yourself nuts.
Yeah. You get infinite feedback loop.
I don't know if anybody had a chance to see the recent shadow transit of Callisto on Jupiter. That was pretty interesting.
Yeah, I got to see that. That's pretty unusual because usually Callisto will pass above or below.
So right.
It has to be aligned just right to see that.
Yeah, so you want to catch that one when you have a chance. I saw the ingress of it was very close to the time indicated in Sky Intel. You could detect a little chip out of the side of Jupiter pretty easily because Jupiter was in a good part of the sky early on, not near the meridian. But later on, when you're trying to watch the shadow exit, a lot like around 11:30 at night, much harder to get a good look with much poorer seeing lower in the sky.
And you know, you could tell the shadow is almost all penumbra. It's really fuzzy, as opposed to Io, which is like an ink spot across. I mean, Ganymede, you can see also is very fuzzy, but Callisto even more so.
Ganymede really hates it when you call it fuzzy.
Now, what's even rarer are transits of Saturn's moons.
Yeah.
Titan does them, but you can only see them for like a very brief period. I think it's twice every 30 years when the rings are exactly edge on. So that would be interesting to see.
If you live long enough.
Yeah. Well, I guess the next edge on rings will be what, about 7 years, something like that.
I thought sooner than that. I thought the rings are getting closer to.
Yeah, maybe they're starting to close.
Yeah, they're starting to close.
Years. And then you get a, like a short period of maybe just a couple of months, if even that. And you need pretty good seeing too, because I think Titan is like one arc second or a little less.
I think the best thing I saw on Jupiter so far is a triple shadow transit. That was quite a while ago now, but yeah. That was pretty remarkable. And to see once in a while, you'd see a moon pass over one of those shadows and wink the shadow out. It's really pretty creepy.
That's probably about the most you can do. Because I guess in principle, you could have a quadruple, but I don't know that that would ever happen, though. So yeah. Here, just have Callisto do a transit.
Right. I think the next triple is far away, too. It's not happening anytime soon.
And, of course, it always happens that it's like only night in, you know, the middle of the Indian Ocean or something. So we can't see it. And if it does happen at a good time for us, then it's cloudy. Mm-hmm. This should be fun. Dale was my first astronomy professor when I was at NJIT. So I've known him for over 20 years. He always gives a good presentation.
So when is the sun going to become active again? It hasn't been very active for a long time.
We're in cycle 25 now. It's just starting. So over the next couple of years, it should ramp up.
I haven't been seeing a lot of noise about sunspot activity.
It's been pretty rare, but they're seeing them now with the polarity reversed, which means they're cycle 25 spots.
Okay.
I think Dale will know a lot more than I do, so he's the guy to ask. I just know from ham radio that they're telling us that solar activity should be going up over the next couple of years. I think they said we hit the official minimum last December.
Right.
They're on the way.
That's what I heard too. Janet, that's an interesting view we have of you. Giant fingers.
She was a hand model in an earlier life.
I think she's trying to use the force on us.
Ivory soap model or
palm olive.
Ah.
Madge.
I'm very sorry. Howard asked me a question and I couldn't figure out how to make my regular keyboard work. So I have to make my other keyboard work.
Your irregular keyboard. You just could say yes.
Well, it's not so yes. Oh dear. All right. I'll be done in a minute.
No. It's actually pretty cool. It's a good Halloween thing.
I was actually playing with the filters a little bit. I never noticed them in Zoom before. Totally silly.
Better.
Thanks, Janet.
Just so you all know, I'm not at my house, and there's dogs and cats here, so if you hear chasing around and such, that's what you see, what you're hearing.
So you're literally in the doghouse.
Pretty much, yeah. And there's two young kids, two young boys, so they'll be screaming and yelling. But I'll mute if that starts happening.
We know how to mute you.
So you're babysitting Roy, I take it?
No, actually, I'm at my girlfriend's sister's house, and we're camping in the backyard tonight.
Oh, very nice.
So I have my tent set up in the backyard.
And a very warm sleeping bag, I hope.
Yes, and a Cherry Springs sweatshirt.
Hold out there.
And probably about 5 blankets. Hmm. So, Harold, how was your vacation?
It was wonderful. I had always wanted to go down the shore after Labor Day and finally got a chance to do it. And it was wonderful. It was very nice.
Good.
But there was no stargazing to be had. Every time I would go out on our balcony, you know, planning to pull my binoculars out, it's just clouds.
Well, at least you got away.
I did.
It brings up the mystery of life question. Why do we go down the shore instead of down to the
up
shore?
Up the mountains, right.
Never understood that.
Always down the shore.
Up the mountains.
Right.
Yeah, up the mountains. They in Minnesota, in Minneapolis, they say going to the lake for anything upstate.
Mm-hmm. Of course, there's always going up the country. Got to get away.
I had read someplace that the down the shore part came from logging centers up in New York State, I believe, and they would, or somewhere, that they would transport the logs down the river and out the Delaware River to the ocean. Mm-hmm. That's where it all came from.
Interesting.
Frank, have you made any progress on plugging the leak on the ISS?
Chewing gum. Left. With duct tape over it, you know?
There you go.
Anyone seen the telescope, which could be yours? I'll have to find a place to hang all my masks, though.
But you have to wipe it down if somebody buys it.
Yeah. The finder's got corona now.
That would make it a solar telescope. Yeah.
I heard from Adam Chantry today. He's ended up doing that. They can't have the planetarium open, obviously, but he's been doing these monthly videos as a substitute. So I'm going to post a link on the website. They're pretty cute.
It's cool.
Yeah.
Good thing. He's a smart guy, that guy, Adam.
Yeah. Since there wasn't any work at the planetarium, really, he got to be, he's the advisor for the school district for virtual learning.
Wow.
Because he's good at it.
Well, the nice thing about the virtual meetings is you can join from pretty much anywhere.
Mm-hmm.
So, I haven't had a chance to show up at any DVAA meetings for a long time, but I can certainly join online from the comfort of my own office here. So that's pretty nice. And I think anybody who wants to join maybe one of the Albuquerque Astronomical Society meetings could probably do that remotely. And it's a pretty big club in Albuquerque, maybe 300 members, something like that. We have another club in Rio Rancho, which I got nominated to be the president of this year. And we only have maybe 30 members, but maybe 10 or 12 really active members. So it's a small club.
We have
trouble getting critical mass to do much.
Do you have a website for both or just the one?
For the Rio Rancho Club, it's rrastro.org.
Okay. Could you put both of them in the chat?
In the chat room?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I can do that. Just type it in here. So it's rrastro.com. If I could see, I'd be dangerous here. rrastro.org, and then the Albuquerque Astro Society is TAAS.org.
Hey, John, do you know Becky and Shane?
Oh, sure.
Becky, wow, what a coincidence. Yeah, yeah.
Yep. Yeah, nice people. They live in Edgewood, I believe, out that way.
Yeah, up in the hills. Yeah, they're old friends. Met them in Texas, and now they're out there. And I used to live in Philly. I live in New York now, so this is the first time I've been on a Zoom meeting last meeting I was at might have been before I moved to New York in 2005. But it's good to see everyone. I see all the emails, but never met most of you.
Well, welcome, Scott.
Shane is quite an astrophotographer. I don't know if you've seen some of his work. We'll spend months on one astro photo.
I know. Yeah, I mean, I've sat right next to him while he's imaging at Texas, and he's pretty serious. Becky's very, very serious visual observer and artist and photographer,
She's also the Alcon coordinator for TESS.
Hey, Dale, welcome.
Hey, Jeremy, how's everyone?
Pretty good. How are you doing?
I'm good.
So how are things up at NJIT?
I don't know, I'm hardly there. I just go in 2 days a week for my class, but.
So you're doing classes on site?
Yep.
Yeah, about the same here. I'm going in 1 or 2 days a week. I have one class that's in person and the rest are all remote.
Yeah, I'm teaching freshmen this year, and they want to have the freshmen have the opportunity to be there. Although I don't have that many students in class. They mostly want to be online. So.
So you're doing physics 111.
Yeah.
Yes, this is the DVAA. Actually, we've got some people joining from various areas. John is actually in New Mexico now. So he's joining us via distance.
But he left a piece of himself in my shed.
Which piece was that?
It is a very big mirror in my shed right now.
Really?
Wasn't that yours?
Not my mirror, no. I didn't leave anything. Oh. I'm sure
John Szymborski, I think.
Oh. Yep. My bad.
It was the wrong answer. You should have said, yeah, I've been waiting for you to speak.
Right.
It's about time.
So, John, where in New Mexico are you?
In Rio Rancho, which is right outside Albuquerque.
Right.
It's northwest of Albuquerque.
I spent a year in Socorro.
Oh, nice. Okay.
2010. I loved it there. I love it in New Mexico.
And when you go west from Socorro down Route 60, you get places that are really cool. BLA for one, but you could get Daddle, which is a neat place to camp. And you've got Lena, where they have the Enchanted Sky Star Party.
And I went to, can't remember the name of the town, but I remember there's a statue of the sheriff from Socorro. There was somebody was in town causing trouble, and the sheriff from that town went to Socorro, got the sheriff from Socorro to come, and the sheriff from Socorro took care of the guy, shot him. I don't know what he did, but there's a bronze statue of him. This is almost in Arizona. It must have taken him a week and a half to walk there.
Okay. There's also just down the road, Pie Town. I was in Pi Town and bought some pies in Pi Town. They were excellent.
Yeah. I haven't thought of Pi Town in 10 years now. Yeah. But I was in Hatch one day. I went to school in at Socorro at New Mexico Tech for a year for geology. Okay. And I can't do math, so I had to leave. Essentially, math is like not a foreign language, it's a alien language to me. It just doesn't compute to me. I love it, and I love people who can do math, but I just can't do it.
That's why I became an organic chemist.
I'm sorry?
That's why I became an organic chemist. I can only count to four.
At New Mexico Tech, no matter what major you take, you have to take two semesters of calculus and two semesters of physics or chemistry. Mm-hmm. And there was no way I was going to get through that.
I have a friend who just bought some property in Camado, New Mexico. If you want to go someplace really dark, he's got about 13 acres, I think, he bought there, sitting nice. On a nice hill. And it's a beautiful spot there. I can't wait to go camp out there and try out the skies.
Well, I was looking online the other day for land in New Mexico, and there's a ranch that's selling off 40-acre lots for $8,900 for the lot. There's nothing there. I mean, there's apparently electricity and phone.
Yeah, I guess one issue is that my friend has figured out is that if you want to dig a well, that might be the most expensive part of the whole operation.
Yeah, yeah.
It's like $35 a foot or something like that. You might have to go down 500 feet to get some water.
And there are no building codes. So you could just pour a big pile of concrete and build your house on top of that and nobody would care. It's funny because people do that. They just get like long boards, make a square out of it. Doesn't even have to be square, just some sort of square shape. Fill it with concrete, let it dry, and then build a house on it. And
how they live. Very one of the challenges, one of your big challenges is finding a builder who's going to build a home for you. So a lot of people get a pre-manufactured home delivered.
Yeah. Yep.
And they'll put on their foundation that way. Mm-hmm. Other people just bring their RVs and, you know, they buy a piece of land and then bring their RV up from Phoenix or wherever they live and use that as their camping out spot.
That's not a bad idea too.
Yeah, but you can get a lot of land for not a lot of money.
Yeah.
There's another New Mexican in your presence. Tracy lived in Albuquerque.
Okay.
For about 7 years.
Hey, John.
How you doing, Gary?
Good, good. Good to see you.
Yeah, it's been a while.
I know. Tracy lived out there for 7 years. That's actually where we met. We met out there.
I worked at University of New Mexico Hospital in Albuquerque and lived in the foothills of the Sandia Mountains.
Sure. Yeah, we're up in Rio Rancho, so not too far away.
Yep. Great place.
You enjoying it?
I'm loving it. Yeah. If I drive north about 20 miles, I can get someplace really nice and dark. It's not too dark in Rio Rancho, but 20 miles up the road, it's pretty darn good.
That's great. That's great.
Where do you go?
I go to White Ridge Bike Trails parking area, which is near San Ysidro.
Okay. So yeah.
Route 550. And then there's a dirt road about 5 miles down the dirt road is the parking area.
Nice.
Sounds nice. You get those big skies out there.
Yeah. Except, you know, I didn't really realize when I moved that the moon is actually up for 2 weeks out of the month, you know. Oh, well.
Oh, yeah, that's right. It doesn't really set because your altitude's so high.
Doesn't make a difference. You know, you still have the moonlight to deal with.
Right. Yeah.
Still, the drier air doesn't hurt either.
Now, if we could collapse the moon to a black hole.
There you go.
we would still have the tides and stabilization of the Earth's axis, but well, and occasionally you get little micro lensing events. You could micro lens the Crab Nebula and stuff.
Oh, there you go. But we wouldn't get to see the beautiful moon.
So take a lot of pictures now while you can.
That's right.
Anybody read Neal Stephenson's Seven Eves? It's a novel that begins with something striking the moon and breaking it into seven parts, which ultimately crashed down on Earth, plunging it into 5,000 years of the surface being uninhabitable.
Wow.
Oh, wow.
Fascinating.
Is it good? Yeah.
It was good. Some people fled underwater. Some people fled into caves, and some people fled into space. It sort of sets the time in the not too distant future when we're already mining asteroids and so forth. But the ISS is still there.
Cool.
But to read Neal Stephenson is to make a commitment, because I don't think any of his books are less than 500 pages.
Mm.
So after reading it, where would you flee to?
Probably space.
Things didn't fare well
in the caves.
In the caves and in the ocean.
No, he doesn't adequately explain what happened underwater. And he doesn't really explain what happened in the caves. He mostly follows what happened in space.
Oh, okay. Mm. Cool. Was that Scott Ewart I saw?
Yeah, that's me.
How you doing?
Wow,
good
Scott.
To see you, Gary. Tracy.
Good to see you, man.
Yeah.
We were talking about you, 2 weeks ago? We were saying, I wonder what's going on with Scott. It's a nice surprise to see you.
Oh, yeah, I'm glad to be here. I guess I've seen the emails and the Zoom announcements, and I guess I've just forgotten or whatever, but I'm glad I finally made the appointment, and yeah, good to see you.
Same here. You doing well?
Yeah.
Excellent.
Looks like you've got a Hawaii background.
Actually, Tahiti.
Tahiti. Okay.
Yeah. Yeah, this was 2010. I guess you knew about that, right? I might have talked about it.
I don't think so.
Mm-mm.
I'll have to send you. Did anybody get the September Sky and Telescope? Anybody subscribe? Really?
Mm-hmm.
What's in it? Yeah, the very back page. I got my story published. Focal point column.
Oh wow!
Yeah. That,
oh no.
So
I'll have to go grab that.
I'll email it right after the meeting. I can email it.
Yeah, please do. I'd love to. Look at it. Read it.
And I have the alternate version, the version I would have liked to see published, so you can see if you can see the differences.
Okay, that sounds good.
Yeah, I lost a pretty major, at least major to me, editorial battle. So, yeah.
The editors always win, though, unfortunately.
Yeah. Their sandbox.
They have last say. Yeah. That's good. Well, I'm glad to hear you're doing well. So it's really good to see you.
Yeah.
Where are you located? Where are you living?
Orange County, New York. I don't know if anyone knows Orange County Choppers, not far from Newburgh.
Okay. Yeah.
So, I'm about 10 miles from there, I guess.
Okay. Yeah. So you're still relatively close.
Yeah. And I got pretty good skies here too. I mean, I'm like 50 miles from New York City as the crow flies.
Is that it?
Oh, there you go.
Hey.
There you go.
I can't read that fast, Harold.
I'm trying to make sure you can see it all.
Well, yeah, like I said,
I'm just joking.
I can email it later.
Yeah, please do. Yeah, I was only kidding.
That's great.
Mm-hmm. Thanks.
Well, I was supposed to go to Tahiti last May, but didn't happen.
Oh, wow.
Oh, no.
And we were supposed to go to Japan. That didn't happen either.
Oh, man. It's a rough year for travel, that's for sure.
Mm-hmm. Well, there's always the next decade.
Yep. Yeah. Spoken like a true optimist.
Well, I see 733, and okay. Lewis is here. So
that's all that counts, right?
All my reporters, everybody who has to report is here, I think. So we'll get started in that way. Dale doesn't have to wait till 10 o'clock to come on. So greetings, everybody. Glad to see you. I do need to go back to sharing my screen. I want to wish everybody a very happy 134th birthday. Let me get that going. Hold on. Let me close this. Slideshow from beginning. Back up, share screen. There we go. So it's everybody knows it's Robert's 134th birthday.
Duh.
Did you bring your party hats and noisemakers? Because we're talking about none other than Robert Trumpler, who was born on October 2nd of 1886, a mere 134 years ago in Zurich, Switzerland. He died in 1956 in Berkeley, and he was a Swiss-American astronomer who worked for a while at the Lick Observatory. He schooled in Zurich and then transferred, got his PhD in 1910 there. And in 1915, during World War I, he emigrated to the United States. Joined the University of California. He was at Allegheny Observatory for a while and then went to the Lick Observatory, as you see here. He was a naturalized citizen in 1921 and was eventually elected a member of the United States Academy of Natural Sciences. But he's most well known for observing that the brightness of more distant open clusters was lower than expected and that stars appeared redder than they should be. This was explained by the interstellar dust scattered throughout our galaxy, resulting in the absorption of light or interstellar extinction of light. So, and then he went and, not being satisfied with that, he actually developed the Trumpler system of identifying clusters of stars. So the first part is a Roman numeral, and you can see across that this is a pastiche of 12 different clusters with different classifications. The degree of concentration is the Roman numeral. Roman numeral one are detached clusters with strong central concentrations, and then they go all the way down to Roman numeral four, where they're not well detached from the surrounding star field. And then you have a range of brightness. So, and that's a number from one, two, or three. Most of the cluster stars are the near or same apparent brightness. That would be a one, and two would be a range in brightness, and three would be both bright and faint stars. And then the letters R, M, and P stand for poor is P, less than 50 stars. M is medium rich, which is 50 to 100 stars, and R are rich, more than 100 stars. So, and this particular sample you have here, they're mostly two and threes. But the Pleiades, for example, are 13RN, and the Hyades are considered 13RM. So for doing this brilliant work, he got a bunch of star clusters named after him, such as Trumpler 2, which is in Perseus. That's an open cluster, and about 2,000 light years from Earth. And Trumpler 14, which is also serving as my background tonight. Trumpler 14 and Trumpler 16 are in the Carina Nebula, fairly close together. 16's not far away either. And he adds to his numbering system an N if there's a nebulosity in the cluster. And then you have 15, which is also in Carina, but a little bit further distant. By that I mean a little bit more outside of, and then he also has Trumpler 27, which is an open cluster in Scorpius, about 4,000 to 6,800 light years away. He also has a lunar crater named after him, and that's on the far side of the moon. And he has a Mars crater named after him, which is why it's so cool that on his birthday, the moon and Mars are in conjunction tonight. So pretty cool, real happy coincidence. I've been looking forward to his birthday for all of September, waiting for this night. On another front, less astronomical, if it's October, December has to be close, and that means elections, and it means committee positions, and none of us have hegemony on our positions. I enjoy being president, but if somebody else wants to do it, my goodness, by all means, step into the fray. We have a vice president. I know Mike Tucker would like to stay as vice president. Lewis Berman is treasurer. He's treasurer because after being president, he thought it was the hardest thing he ever did. And I told him, no, that's treasurer. So we traded places.
just for fun.
And Lewis, I'm pretty sure you got the short end of that stick.
Oh, I'm burnt out. Trust me.
We have secretary. And you can't tell from this, but three of these positions are taken up by Janet Rush. And we can't burn her up. She's secretary. She's doing outreach. And you know what I noticed, Janet? I don't have up here newsletter editor up here. That's another position that should be up here. We need somebody for scope rentals. Brian Lee has been doing welcoming. Lewis is serving as data protection officer and treasurer. Nate has pretty much been doing camping. I think Roy, you just took over as door prizes.
Yes.
Al is Night Sky Network. Light pollution is Dennis. Observing is Andrew. And astrophotography, that's our newest position, is Lou, whom I haven't heard his text message ringtone, so I guess he's not on the meeting yet. But if you're interested, step forward. I wrote about this in the newsletter. We really, we're a very active club with a lot of moving parts, and the more the merrier. And you don't have to, embarrass yourself. You don't have to raise your hand tonight. You can email me at president@dvaa.org. And if you don't want to, if that's an intimidating email address, all that really results in is I get more spam to president@dvaa.org. Especially from Lewis, from spoofed Lewis addresses wanting me to go get gift cards.
How much was the last one for? It was incredible. I think it was $87,000.
Yeah.
You're supposed to remit.
Right.
It was pretty wonderful.
Right. I mean, it was happening when I was treasurer and Lewis was president. It was the same nonsense. Or ehgoldner@gmail.com, or you can call, you can send me a private tweet. Yeah. Private message on Twitter if you choose, or you can call my cell phone. The only proviso in calling my cell phone is that if I don't recognize your number, I won't answer, but you'll leave a message and I'll call you back. But let us know. We need more people, and we can't burn our people out. We need
Harold,
more people involved. Yep.
Can I give a plug?
Please.
We often talk about these positions. They suck. They're hard. We take a lot of effort and stuff too. And we love to complain. We're good at complaining, right? It's really important. And just using my own story, there's no question that my appreciation and joy in being a member of this club starts and ends with volunteering, you know, and I complain about as much as anybody, probably more and stuff. But I assure you, I know more people, and I'm friends with more people, and I've had better experiences, and I felt like my participation, and just on those days I'm tired to go, and I would very much recommend volunteering, and quite frankly, in every guise, not just the chairs and stuff that Harold was talking about. Participating turns out to be the secret sauce, at least in my opinion.
I have I've had a lot of fun. I've been on a lot of boards, and I've probably had more fun doing this than anything else. And Roy Patton reminds me we have a member at large too. I think the member at large, more than one member at large, because I think we amended the bylaws to provide for up to three members at large now. So those will be elected too. So let us know. It's really, it's work, but it's fun work. And it distributed, it's just amazing how much we've gotten done this year, notwithstanding the pandemic. It really is amazing. So please feel free to jump aboard. And that's the end of Janet.
Just wanted to say one more thing, if I could, about the member at large.
Go for it.
One of the reasons we expanded the position from one position to three was because the purpose of that position is to represent the membership when there are important issues that we need to talk about on the board, because these are board positions. So what we'd like is to have those three member at large, represent different types of membership. So and get some diversity in there. So brand new members, it would be great to have a brand new member in one of those positions, a woman, person of color. That's the point of having three, so that we can get some diversity on the board and have our membership represented on the board.
Yep. Unlike your benefits, there's no minimum length of time you have to be here before you can run for any of those offices or volunteer. And with that, I'm going to toss it to Brian.
Good evening, everyone. We have five new members this month. Mary Turchi, Francis Jennings, Cherise Walker, Richard Ng, and Lauren Merkel. And I think this actually might be the most we've had since, the pandemic started. So
that's great. Thanks. Thank you. And now back to you, Lewis.
Sure. And you're right. It is the most we've had, Brian. And we have 157 active members now. And it's starting to become that time of year. I'm going to say this over and over, and I will send off emails. And we did the data cleanup project earlier this year, and we're going to do another version of that in November. Prior to, counting our votes and everything. And so the idea is we're going to want you to re-up. Please re-up. Your dollars help. They help, like, for instance, to do these remote meetings as an example. And so I'll explain how it goes. But again, we're going to ask everyone in late December to re-up then. Thank you.
Thanks, Lewis. Nate's not here to talk to us about Cherry Springs, but I know folks went up there. Anybody want to report on how Cherry Springs went? I guess it was a week or so ago.
Sure, I could.
Please.
It was, let's see, I guess there were three of us. Al Lamperti and Joe Lamb and I were there. And it was a really kind of heartbreak because the skies were absolutely cloudless, absolutely beautiful, but we had the smoke haze. And that really impaired the ability to observe. In fact, Joe and Al both went home after one night because it was a disappointment. But good companionship with everybody and with Chester County. Chester County was up there. They stayed the whole time.
And I think, Jeremy, you put an announcement out. Chester County is having a public meeting, Zoom meeting, in a couple of weeks.
Yeah, on October 13th, which I think is a week from Tuesday, they're going to have John Conrad, who's presented to us a few times. He's always done a really great job.
Yeah.
So he's going to be talking about global climate change, the view from space. So he gave us that presentation maybe about 2 or 3 years ago. So he's going to update it quite a bit for all the newest data from 2019 and 2020. So that should be good.
Great. Thank you. Night.
And I sent out the YouTube link.
Thank you. And Janet, we're back to you.
Okay. Relative to outreach, we did have two successful outreach events face-to-face. It was fun. And that was in July and August. And then I'll let Andrew talk about the plans of how we're going to roll the format into the Valley Forge Star parties. So that's really all on outreach. Oh, we do have a couple of events scheduled, outdoor events scheduled for April. So hope we can do those. If I could talk for a second about the auction, we're making good progress. Lewis and I worked together and set up the new auction site, and all the items are loaded there. We're ready to press go as soon as we get the payments part worked out. So yep. It's making progress.
And I'm going to work on that this weekend.
Oh, great.
Super. Thank you. So Andrew, we're going to go to you now for the observing report. And I am going to, because Andrew, you're going to probably show slides and stuff, I'm going to kill my video and I'm going to keep it off so that Jeremy can take on, can introduce our guest after that.
Okay. Can everyone hear me okay?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Okay, great. So I will share screen here. The host is disabled screening. Can you enable my screening, please, Jeremy?
Yeah.
Since I asked so nicely.
All right, you should be able to.
There we go. Okay. All right, so my name is Andrew Hishner. I'm the observing chair. Of course, Harold mentioned that elections are coming up. I don't believe observing chair is particularly like an elected position. I'm happy to keep doing it. I'm having a lot of fun. But if anybody is really interested, you can talk to me and we can talk about transitioning it. But again, I'm having a good time and I hope you guys enjoy the talks and star parties and all. And speaking of the star parties, before I mention any of the format, I just really want to give a shout out to Wayne and Gary for all of the work that they've done. So unfortunately, this past star party was cloudy, so we weren't able to have it. But Wayne and Gary have been putting a lot of time, their personal time, in developing this kind of setup where they have like the revolution imagers and they have different focal lengths and field of view. So you can see constellations and deep sky objects. And they've been going out, setting up projectors, figuring out the power sources, figuring out the timing of things. Gary wrote this whole script and everything. And it's just absolutely phenomenal. And I can't thank you guys enough. So big shout out to all you guys. So now, if you're wondering what star parties are going to look like, so we are doing them again. We, unfortunately, September was cloudy, so we have October and November. And then whatever the climate's like next year, the COVID climate, I have no idea. But we have two coming up. And it's going to start at sunset still, but we're going to have some stations, if you will. So Al is kind enough to lend some stations that he has, some like posters and things. And we're going to talk about things like the moon, the life of the universe, the life of stars, binocular observing apps and such. So the public can go around and they kind of see those, stay in small groups, travel station to station, while Gary and Wayne set up their telescopes for observing. And then when it finally gets dark enough, I'll do a short tour of the sky, and then Gary and Wayne will follow along with their revolution imagers and cameras, and then kind of show what I'm pointing out in the sky. So that's what it is. The public are more than welcome, and you as club members are more than welcome to come and bring your own scopes and binoculars, although there's no sharing of equipment with COVID, of course. And there are a limited number of participants. However, we didn't reach like the max number before. So if you want to come sign up, don't worry about really taking a public spot, especially with these colder months coming. I don't think that's really going to be a problem. So if you want to come to a star party, come. But that's what the star parties are going to look like. And unfortunately, again, September, we put a lot of work into it and the September is clouded out, but hopefully October will be better. So, all right. So moving into the observing report, So before I get to the actual observing report, we have two astronomical leave awards. So first, congratulations to Al for completing the NOVA program, the silver. So to get this, Al observed 50 total NOVA objects, including NOVA, supernova, and a dwarf NOVA. And Al got number 9, and I think this is he got the 9th certificate, and I think this is a relatively new program. There's two levels. There's 50 will get you silver, and then 100 observations, which Al said he's working on, will get you the gold. So it's pretty cool. Check it out. NOVA is not really something that we think about seeing a lot. But hey, there's 100 objects up there that you can go look at. So check it out if you're interested. And then congrats to Mike Pascavage for completing the Double Star program. This is a great program. I'm working on it myself. 100 total observations of double stars, which are really fun to observe. So congratulations, Mike. So Janet actually mentioned what the motivation for this talk was. And I wanted to talk about this month weather apps, because I, like Al and Janet, who are up at Cherry Springs, I was down in Shenandoah for the past new moon. Very excited. I was gonna do some like wide field landscape astrophotography. It was gonna be great. And all the forecasts said clear, it'll be wonderful. I scoped out a place and then I get there and I can't see anything. And I'm checking all the apps, what's going on? And says clear, should be great, but this, of course, then the smoke was just covering everything up. So I wanted to point out some really popular apps, some that I've used up until, what I've used for a while, and then one more that I actually found was really helpful, especially for the smoke thing that we're having, this problem. So, and then these are also some of the apps that I use to call the star parties too. So kind of a little bit of insider information here. And I'm going to focus on ones that is particular for astronomy, ones that have an astronomical focus, especially for things like scene and transparency, and of course, cloud cover, and then also some other general things like temperature and such. But now on that note, of course, I'll start with things like weather.com and AccuWeather. So we all know these. It shows a really broad overview of the conditions. In this snapshot here, we got like where I live, Phoenixville, we got today's forecast broken up into kind of 4 chunks. You scroll down, you get the hourly and like the weekly. It gives you hourly and daily again. I have found that it's pretty easy. If you click on like the daily, you can find like the sunrise, sunset. It now gives you moonrise and moonset too, which is kind of nice. But you need to be careful because sometimes moonrise and moonset will span the course of a night. So we'll be on 2 different days. So just be careful about that. But it's not really astronomical focused. And of course, it's more clickbait really than weather. Now, I'll go back. I'll show you some of the websites that I'm talking about tonight, like kind of a live thing. I'm not going to show you this. Of course, if you scroll down, there's all this stuff that doesn't matter about weather. But moving on to more serious ones. So what I consider the kind of the next upgrade, kind of the default that we all go to, is the clear sky chart. I call it the dark sky clock for whatever reason. I don't know if anybody else calls it that, but I do. So it gives you an 84-hour forecast and in 1-hour blocks. And this is really designed for amateur astronomers. So you can see on the bottom there, it shows cloud cover, transparency and scene right at the top, darkness to see when the moon will set and when it will finally get the darkest out that it will. A new addition, the smoke layers at the top. I don't remember that being there. Now, this isn't the one that I primarily use anymore, so it's been a while, but they do have the smoke layer on there now, and they have things like wind, humidity, temperature. It's nice to look at. A downside, it only shows specific locations. So I show Blue Mountain Vista Observatory, and this is ran by a single person, I think. So he doesn't have just a really general enter in an address and go find the forecast. You need to kind of work with him so that he can set it up. And then there are, of course, paid programs and stuff to get more information, but this is usually what you'll see. And it doesn't break up the cloud layer. So even though it says cloud cover, it kind of lumps everything all into one. So if we go here, I think it's this guy here. So here's what you would see. It's nice because you can hold your mouse over it and it will give you what the block is. So here's 20% covered tomorrow morning, the scene's a poor 2 out of 5. And if you forget what the scale is for transparency and scene, you can just scroll down here and it will show you give you some information on transparency, on seeing such darkness, what the different colors mean. It's pretty nice. Another thing you might not know is that you can click on the block. So if I click on transparency here, it will come up with a satellite view of the forecasted transparency at that time. Now it's a little primitive. I can't scroll around here. If I wanted to pan, there's a button that says like, oh, pan north, pan south. So it's a little hard to use, not the most user friendly, but it's pretty good. I use this for a long time, pretty reliable, although it's always good to check it with other sources. So moving on, the next one that I want to talk about is Meteo Blue. So this is one of the ones that I use to call star parties. It gives a lot of detail. So you can kind of think of it as the weather, what you wish the Weather Channel would be, or what the weather.com could be. It has a lot of really helpful graphs, which I'll show you, of like cloud. It breaks up into cloud altitudes. It gives you like rainfall graphs and things, the wind direction over the course of the time. And it just has a bunch of satellite and radar images. As you keep scrolling, can you see more and more of this stuff? And what I really like is that it shows you the forecast from different weather models. So all of these apps really pull data from the same sources, right? But it's kind of like an integrated, you see one forecast. Well, Meteo Blue is nice because it kind of takes all of them into account. You can even look at each model, weather model, independently. And Meteo Blue, if you just go to the website and type in your location, it will show you the general weather. But there's also what I've shown here, a specific astronomical scene forecast. So here you have the hour on the left, and then you have the clouds broken up in the altitudes, which is nice, and then scene. And I keep talking about the clouds broken up. It's really nice when it has that, because some sites like weather.com and AccuWeather, it will say that it's clear, but they don't take into account really high altitude cirrus clouds. So it could be clear, and then you get out there and you say, well, it's cloudy. Why is it supposed to be clear? Well, those are really high altitude clouds, which those other websites don't take into account. So when I'm thinking of a weather site, I really try and look for these layers to see if it's a viable site. So here's an example for Philadelphia. It's a lot of information all at once, so you need to take your time. But here I have the week up here, and I can click around, and it then breaks down into the hours over here. And again, so it shows for each day, the weather forecast has this predictability. And by high predictability, that means that a lot of the models are saying the same thing. And then if I click, again, it doesn't really correlate to how many days in advance you're looking at. It correlates to what all of the models are predicting. So here it has low predictability, Monday. So that's meaning that some of the models will say thunderstorms, some of the models might say clear. So of course it will dial in as you get closer, but for now it's pretty low. Before I show you the models, I'll just keep scrolling down. This I use a lot. It breaks up the cloud cover here, and then the darker parts are thicker clouds, the lighter parts are more medium thickness clouds, breaks up in altitude. It also shows you the precipitation, which is nice. If you wanted a wind speed, that information is down here. You can just keep scrolling. Here's a satellite view, and scroll down. And then here's the radar view and precipitation forecast. And then to look at the different models, you can click here, multi-model. And here is a graph of the temperature from each of the models, the precipitation forecast, and then each model broken up into a kind of hourly fashion. You can match up the hours here, which you do, to see what each one is forecasting. Super handy when trying to go out, determine if you're going out. And then I like to, if you go down to outdoor and sports here, there's an astronomical scene forecast. So you can click on that, and now you're getting something pertaining to astronomy. So we're breaking up the hours here. It even shows you when the moon's gonna be out. And then these colors here represent darkness. So here the sun's out, here's kind of the astronomical twilight, and now it's finally dark enough. And then you have the clouds broken up the altitudes, and then you have scene. It doesn't show you transparency, but it does show you scene, which is good because the scene will vary a lot even if it's not cloudy out, right? Then of course the jet stream and some of the other things. I also like here that it gives you the celestial bodies, which is kind of nice. It will show you what planets are out, Mars and Venus, Venus and Uranus, and then more down here. And you can keep scrolling down. It gives you looks like it gives you about 48 hours or so. So that's Meteo Blue, kind of an enhanced weather.com. So Clear Outside. So this is a great app for use. I'll show you the desktop version. I think the app's a little better. This is one that I probably go to the most. This is my go-to checker to quickly see what is it going to be like out at the time and night when I want to go to observe. So it gives you a 7-day hourly forecast. Again, there's both a website and an app. It breaks down into the clouds, into the different altitude layers. And it's also nice, I also use it for landscape photography. So it gives you kind of a fog metric down here, fog percent. So if I'm looking to like go shoot some woodland photography or something, and I want it to be kind of foggy, it's pretty good at predicting if it will be foggy in like Valley Forge or so, and I can go there and take some photos. And it's also nice, it gives you ISS passes in each hour. So if I show you that guy, that's the next one, here it is. So again, it's a lot of information to look at. It takes a little bit of use to getting used to it. But I really like the app. I didn't even know there was a desktop version, but you can go to clearoutside.com and get it. Right off the bat, for each hour, it will code it. It will color code it based on if it's good or not for observing. So green is good, of course. Yellow, so-so. And then red, probably not good. And it's not just based on cloud cover. It's also based on things like transparency and seeing. So you have the darkness bar here. It will show you the moon phase. You have the different clouds broken up right at the top in the different layers. You see low clouds and medium clouds are both zero, but those high cirrus clouds, 86%, I guarantee you, if you go to weather.com and look at 5 a.m. tomorrow, it will say that that's clear. Not clear, not really good for observing. And here's an ISS pass that will happen at 8 o'clock tonight. And then a bunch of different information down here. Here's that fog layer that I really like. Not a lot happening tonight, so there's not a lot of colors, all green. So it's also nice, it gives you the dew point if you're worried about it dewing up or frosting up in the middle of the night, and also the humidity, and of course, that temperature, watch the temperature for layers of clothing. And you can go down and I think you can click on these days, to get an expanded for the next few days. So that's Clear Outside. That is my go-to quick glance, what's happening tonight. So for a little more detail, a lot more detail, this is one that I just found out. Lou pointed it out to me while I was in Shenandoah, because I said, hey, why is it cloudy? Is that smoke? I didn't have internet. I couldn't go look at like the satellite imagery myself. And then Lou said, check out this app, clearly smoke in the sky. So this is a more advanced forecast, an hourly forecast again, and it's really linked to this satellite view up here and then the hourly block, which we're used to seeing down here. It shows, of course, the cloud cover, the transparency and seeing. It doesn't break up the cloud cover in the bars here, although you can see the cloud cover, different layers broken up in the satellite view. There's several satellite maps, which I'll show you several. There's a handy Bortle's dark sky map if you want to look at, where am I? What Bortle class am I? If I drive so-and-so many miles north where it is clear, what is the forecast there? What's the Bortle sky there? And it's really good for in-depth planning, but more than just like a quick glance, if you will. So here is, this is available as an app, which again, I do think is a little easier to use than the desktop version. Desktop version though gives you all of the same functionality. So this is tonight for my home in Phoenixville. You can see the clouds here. And then I believe this is, transparency and then seeing. It also marks the ISS passes here. There's so much information here. It takes a little bit of time. And then you can go down here for a quick look at the extended forecast. But the real power here is that, say I want to look at the transparency, kind of like the dark sky, the clear sky chart, it will bring up a map, but you can pan around, you can click to see, what is it going to be like and such. And then if we go back here, then there's smoke, which I thought was really handy. When I was down in Shenandoah, this purple smoke here was in over most of the eastern United States. which it was really quick and easy to see. You can go back and forth. And then again, they have this, if we go back, they have this light pollution map, which I thought was really handy. And I think there's a way that you can kind of layer this with the clouds and you can see real time. Like if you're observing and you're going for cloud cover, you can see, hey, if I go so many miles in another direction, what is it going to be like in that direction? So those aren't all of the weather apps. There are a bunch of weather apps. There are a bunch of astronomy weather apps. These are for desktop, Android, and Apple. I'm not too familiar with any Apple ones because I have an Android phone, but all of these are available for Android. And these are the ones that I use the most. Not an all-encompassing list. Just wanted to let you know what I use the most, and feel free to mention any that you might find handy as well. So, and that's it for me tonight. Thanks. I will relinquish control.
Thank you, Andrew. Are you going to put that deck up on the site under documents?
Yes, definitely. So that's why I could have done the whole thing, right? Just showing my desktop, but I didn't want to do that. I wanted to make the slide, the chart package too. So
thank you.
Do that. Yep.
Thanks. And we, Delaware Valley Amateur Astronomers has sponsored Attila's website so that he continues to have Blue Mountain Vista featured on that website. We appreciate that.
Yeah.
Thanks, Andrew. That was great. And I think I installed one of those apps while I was watching. Jeremy has a great guest for us. I'm looking forward to this tonight, and take it away.
All right. Thanks, Harold. Yeah, and Clear Sky Chart has the light pollution map linked as well. It's a little tricky to find, but they do as well. All right. So just as a reminder, before we get started with the main event, if you are not the speaker, please turn off your camera and mic during the presentation. Just a little preview of next month. In November, we have Mary Lou West, who is a professor at Montclair State University and also very active in amateur astronomy. She's going to talk about medieval astronomy, what Dante knew in 1300. So that's going to be a really interesting presentation. So tonight we have a special guest speaker, actually someone I've known for a little over 20 years. Back in 1997 or so, I started as a student at NJIT. And right around the same time, Dale Gary started there as a professor and he taught an astronomy course. And I said, oh, great, this is exactly what I want to take. And it's, you know, a good mathematical astronomy course where we calculated stellar structures and all this other great stuff. So really, Dale was one of my first professors at NJIT, so I'm very happy to welcome him back. So Dale is a distinguished professor of physics at the New Jersey Institute of Technology, as well as the Center for Solar Terrestrial Research hosted at NJIT. He's the director of the Owens Valley Solar Array in California, as well as the project scientist for the Frequency Agile Solar Radio Telescope. So Dale did his undergraduate work at the University of Michigan and his PhD in astrogeophysics at the University of Colorado. He's also very active in outreach, including some work with amateur astronomy, as well as Project Astronova, which sends astronomers into schools to work with students. So tonight, Dale will be here to tell us about anatomy of a solar flare. So take it away, Dale.
Okay, great. So let me see if I can share my screen successfully. I think I want screen one. Share, okay. So let's see if I start my presentation. It should show up on that screen, I hope. There we go. So that looks okay for everyone?
Yes.
Great. So this, I'm going to show you a bunch of movies, and these movies I know won't necessarily run smoothly on Zoom, so I hope that they come across okay. If there's any difficulties, there's one movie in particular that I'm going to give you the link to, because you really have to see this one at sort of full bandwidth, so we'll take a look at that one. But the reason I'm interested in sharing with you about this particular solar flare. This is a flare that occurred in 2017. It was sort of the last gasp of the solar cycle that we've just have gone through. And now we're in the depths of solar minimum. So we're really not seeing activity at all. It's just a quiet sun day after day after day. So you think you've got it bad with COVID, you should be a solar astronomer who specializes in solar flares. It's equally bad on the professional side. So, but anyway, we're hopeful that we'll have a new solar cycle coming soon. So I'm going to tell you a little bit about this solar flare. I call it an iconic one because it's just so emblematic of all of the features that we expect to see in solar flares. And many times such such attributes of the flare are kind of hard to see, kind of missing. Maybe they happened, but you just didn't have good data for it. This particular flare was really well observed in 2017. So I'm gonna show you some movies of that and then sort of back up and tell you a little bit about the basics of solar activity just to orient you and go into some, generally some solar flare observations and some models of how we understand what's happening in the solar flare. And then I'll come back to the solar flare of 2017, September 10, and tell you how our instrument, the Expanded Owens Valley Solar Array radio instrument, provided new insights into that particular event. And then of course, be interested in looking ahead at what's going to happen in the next solar cycle. So this particular flare, again, it occurred on September 10th, 2017. It was the last of a string of flares that occurred starting in around September 4th. And because there were so many flares in a row and everyone was all excited about this region, basically everyone was watching this as it transited the west limb. So the sun is rotating and the burst ended up on the edge of the sun and we were able to see it in profile, just a beautiful flare. To put it in perspective, I wanna show you this movie, and this is the one I want you to see at full bandwidth. So I give you a little tiny URL, maybe take a screenshot of this or something so you can go there and see it, but I'm gonna show it to you now and we'll see what the bandwidth does to it.
Dale, can you paste the link into the chat?
I can. So let me stop this for a moment and go back and I can do that. Let me see, I'm going to... I will, oh, wait, stop. I don't want to do that yet. Let me do it from here. I guess I can't while I'm presenting, but I will do so before I'm done, okay? All right, so back to the link. So this is the entire sun. And what you're seeing is a lot of sort of behavior of the quiet sun as it's kind of percolating along. The region we're interested in is over here. And in just about 1 hour of real time, it's going to have a flare. So there we go. And this is a phenomenally impactful flare. You can see that it caused wave patterns to propagate all the way around the distance of the sun. And they actually, if you watch them, they sort of collide and reflect back. It's just a phenomenal thing. Jeremy, how does the play work? Does it look okay or is it pretty jerky?
It's a little bit jerky, but I don't know if that's in the original video.
No, it's very smooth in the original video. So definitely check that out. Actually, why don't I go ahead and I'll just grab this URL and put it in the chat. If I can find the chat. Okay, there you go. But don't look at it now because then you'll miss the rest of my talk. Okay, I'm trying to start it again here. There we go. So This is like a zoom in of that, just to show the part of the flare close to the edge of the sun. And let me try to play that one. And you can see everything looks like it moves pretty fast. And then there's this long period of the solar flare loops. These are called loop prominences, but they're actually just the relaxing aftermath of the flare. As these material on these loops cools down, they become visible. So originally they are there, but they're very, very hot and invisible. And then as they cool down, they become visible in various electromagnetic emission. In this case, it's extreme ultraviolet emission. So it's an extreme ultraviolet image. So we're going to be talking more about this flare, but if you zoom out a bit, you can see the associated something called a coronal mass ejection. So this circle represents the disk of the sun. And this is from the LASCO coronagraph. We're now making an artificial eclipse, basically. So this larger circle is an occulting disk that's covering up the sun. And as I play the movie, you're going to see a running difference movie, where you're seeing what has changed from one time to another. So we'll just go ahead and play that. And boom, we see the event. What's really interesting is that all of this noise here, those are particles from the sun hitting the detector. So the detector is sitting here at Earth. Actually, it's at L1. And those particles arrive in less than an hour and start hitting the detector. So this event was not only produced a huge coronal mass ejection, which is this cloud of magnetic field, but also generated lots of particles that came back to the Earth. So it's the kind of thing that not only is interesting scientifically and fun to watch, but it's also a little bit dangerous if you're out unprotected outside of the magnetosphere of the Earth. So backing up a little bit, if you've ever seen a projected image of the sun in white light, you've seen things like this. It's just kind of a featureless looking disk with, if you're lucky, you will see some large sunspots. These sunspots, this particular group is particularly large, but you'll definitely often see this sort of size if you look at the right time. But in fact, if you look nowadays, you see more like this. This is in 2020, this half of the sun is showing you a recent image as compared to 2024, sorry, 2014, when we had lots and lots of sunspots on the sun. So the number of sunspots, of course, changes dramatically with time. Those images 6 seconds apart really highlight that. But not only does the surface change, but also the atmosphere, the corona. So this shows you what the extreme ultraviolet view of the sun looks like. You're now seeing above the surface and looking at the hot plasma in the atmosphere above the sun. And when you do that, where there are sunspots, you see these loops, these magnetic loops that are related to essentially magnetic fields from the sunspots. And then at times when there are no sunspots, all of that magnetic complexity goes away. You know, you see a few small ones, but it's these big complexes of magnetic fields that are the places where solar flares occur. If you count sunspots, or this particular plot is actually the area of a sunspot in units of percent of the visible hemisphere. So what you see is that the area of sunspots comes and goes. And this is a 150-year plot. So you're seeing many solar cycles coming and going. The peak comes up, and then you have a solar minimum and another maximum. Every 11 years or so, you have those peaks. And of course, the number of sunspots or the area of the visible hemisphere varies a lot from month to month and day to day. But overall, you see just a huge peak where the sunspots become more numerous. But notice that this the peak of this is only 0.5, in other words, 0.5% of the visible hemisphere. So the sun doesn't produce, you know, huge blockages of the surface. Some stars may have tens of percent blockage due to star spots. The sun is active, but not nearly as active as some other stars. So now here we are. This one was, I think this plot was made around 2017 or so, so it doesn't go quite as long as to now. But these are just the raw numbers of sunspots, or the area of the sunspots, total area. But if you look at where they occur on the sun, this is the sun from 90 degrees south to 90 degrees north. So it's just plotting the latitude. And again, the number of sunspots is now in kind of an orange color. So the brighter orange means larger number of sunspots. But they tend to occur at relatively large, relatively high latitudes, either 30 degrees north or 30 degrees south at the beginning of the cycle. And then as the cycle wears on and you come to later and later in the cycle, the sunspots begin to be born on the sun a little bit lower in latitude. So that creates something called a butterfly diagram. These are look a lot like little butterfly wings. So you can see the butterfly behavior of sunspots starting at high latitudes and then evolving toward lower latitudes. I want to point out, though, that an individual sunspot only lives for a few days or a week, perhaps. So they come and go. This is just the locus of where they're born, and different sunspots make up different parts of these butterflies. So let's go back to the white light sun. These are magnetic fields. The strong magnetic fields are producing, inhibiting the convection of heat into the center of the sunspot. So the sunspot appears dark. And those strong magnetic fields, they actually are in a much larger area than this darker or cooler part of the sunspot. So if I show you a magnetic map. This is a magnetic map where the black areas are negative polarity and the white areas are positive. So this would be a positive or north pole of a magnet, and this is a negative or south pole. And these high magnetic fields, of course, are centered in sunspots, but they extend well beyond the sunspots into other parts of the surface. So if you look at the entire sun, you begin to see some interesting patterns. For one thing, the sun is rotating this direction. So if you look at this sunspot, we would call this the leading sunspot because it's in the, in the direction of rotation. So it's as if these two sunspots are, one is chasing the other and the leading one is the one that is furthest west or furthest to this side of the sun. This one you'll notice is white, so it's a plus polarity. But the trailing sunspot, the other sunspot that comes along in these pairs, is a negative polarity. However, if you look at this one up here, you'll see the leading sunspot is a negative polarity and the trailing one is positive. And in fact, if you look at all of the sunspot pairs in the northern hemisphere above the sort of center of the sun here, all of these, you'll find that they're all that way. The leading sunspot is negative, the trailing sunspot is positive. And if you look at the ones in the southern hemisphere, it's the opposite. So that's kind of an interesting pattern. But not only do you have that pattern, when you come to the next solar cycle, you will find this reversed, so that the northern ones will have positive in the leading spot and negative in the trailing spot, and vice versa in the southern hemisphere. So this actually shows you the butterfly diagram again for most of four cycles. And you can see again, the sunspots are occurring here and evolving toward closer to the equator over time. But the colors are indicating the polarity of some kind of an average magnetic field as a function of latitude. So you'll see that this one's dominated by white or yellow in this case. This one is dominated by negative polarity or blue, then it goes back to yellow, then it goes back to blue. And in the southern hemisphere, it's the opposite. And what's interesting is that these regions are the leading sunspot polarity, but the trailing sunspots are of the opposite polarity, of course, and the trailing flux ends up migrating to the poles. So for a given solar cycle, you'll have a majority negative, let's say these blue points in the north, while you have also a negative pole. This is at 90 degrees or at the north pole of the sun. And then the trailing part of the active regions, that flux is migrating to the pole and actually changes the polarity of the entire sun. So now the dipole moment of the sun is reversed. It's now positive in the north and negative in the south. So the sun's sunspot cycle is actually a 22-year cycle. Where are we now in the solar cycle? Well, we're right here in the depths of solar minimum. So we had a relatively small maximum, this past maximum. These are some predictions of what might happen in the future. And here we are, I think, in September 1st. So there is beginning to be an upturn, and it looks like solar activity is coming back. We're finding some smaller active regions. They may not even have sunspots, but they have the right polarity and they're high latitude, and they're clearly going to be part of the new cycle. It's predicted that the next cycle will be very similar to this one, so a relatively small cycle compared to some of the ones that we've had in recent decades. But nevertheless, we're looking forward to the return of some sunspots and solar activity. So let me just show you a couple of examples of solar flares. This is a flare from actually September 10th, the same date I want to show you, but I'm going to be talking about 2017. This is in 2014. And you can watch this movie and watch this sunspot. You'll see the brightenings that occur around that sunspot. So we can zoom in on that. These are images from the Solar Dynamics Observatory. It's a wonderful spacecraft that takes images at a number of wavelengths every 12 seconds. So we get really nice high resolution movies from this satellite. So here we can watch again those brightenings. What these are the locations on the surface or near the surface where particles are raining down on the surface and causing these areas to get hotter. And so they glow in that emission. And they show up bright like that. But if you look a little bit higher up and in hotter lines, this is now in the extreme ultraviolet coronal part up in the atmosphere, higher atmosphere, you watch the thing again and you see that it's quite a bit more dramatic. You can see actually it's saturating the detector, which is causing some of these glitches here, but most of the action is actually occurring up here at high heights and accelerating particles, which are then raining down on the surface to cause these sort of more surface phenomena. But we didn't know any of this until the space age, because we have to get above the atmosphere to see these kinds of emissions. This is another solar flare. This is from 2015. And this is a flare that observed in hydrogen alpha. It's actually off-band hydrogen alpha. So you can see most of the surface just fine, but you'll see some brightenings and darkenings as the hydrogen alpha emission gets brighter or darker in various parts of this off-band line. So let's go ahead and play the movie. This is from Big Bear Solar Observatory. And this is one of the highest resolution movies ever made of a solar flare. This is made from a 1.6 meter solar telescope. And it's got some pretty dramatic features. I wanna kind of back up a little bit and highlight a few of them. So when we get to say here, you can see the brightenings begin. But notice a lot of the activity is up above the surface and is completely invisible. And one of the features of these brightenings is that they lie along a line like this, which is kind of an axis between two polarities. So we got one polarity of magnetic field here and another one here. And there's kind of a neutral line, it's called, a line between those two polarities. And as we move forward, you can see that we begin to get some activity that's seen higher up. And you'll notice that it's mostly along that line. It's kind of aligned with that axis. As we go along further, the ribbon, we call this a ribbon, becomes quite complete now. And you can see that there's, again, parallel to this axis, there's this range of brightening of particles hitting the surface. And as we go on, that moves along almost like a wave moving outward. And as it moves outward, we begin to see some loops that are more angled to this axis. And those loops become more and more angled as we go higher and higher until eventually they're almost perpendicular to the axis. And another thing that's interesting is if you look at where this if you look at where the edge of this ribbon is, later on, right about here, you begin to see the material coming down and falling right where that used to be. These loops existed at the time of the brightening, but they were too hot to be visible. And then after the ribbon has moved on, these loops become visible. They're not moving. They're just becoming visible from the cooler material. And that material then falls down about 40 minutes later. So it gets hot and then it cools down. It takes about 40 minutes for it to start getting cool enough to fall down due to gravity. So those are some of the features of a solar flare seen in hydrogen alpha. The lower loops close to the surface are more highly sheared, which means that they're along the axis as opposed to being across the axis, which is less sheared. Okay, let me go ahead and move on. So the shearing, this is another active region with, again, opposite polarity sunspots, and you've got this sheared magnetic field. It's oriented between. So normally if you had a north and south pole of a magnet, the loops would just connect, right? They wouldn't come out and go all the way down here and connect. So that sheared magnetic field is actually a source of storage of energy. And so this is what's called a flux rope. You can see it almost looks like a braided rope. And that rope is what essentially forms due to the storage of magnetic energy between these sunspot regions. And that becomes unstable and eventually becomes this kind of a feature erupting upward. And then as it erupts upward, behind it is kind of like a vacuum and some, the outer parts of the atmosphere start moving into that region, and it actually causes something called magnetic reconnection, which I'll talk about a little bit later. But you'll notice that behind that are these loops that are more oriented across the region. So the sheared field lines rise up, and behind them are produced a less sheared arcade of loops like this. So this is kind of the picture. Again, you have the flux rope, and if you looked at it in cross section, the fields would kind of be going around. It's kind of like a corkscrew. But where that is moving upward, you can see the velocity is moving upward, and then there's a velocity inflow on either side, just filling in that space. And that carries more magnetic field, but that magnetic field actually is oppositely polarized. So it's going to end up doing something called reconnection. And that reconnection drives jets downward and upward. And it's these downward jets that are producing the very bright loops that we see in the extreme ultraviolet. Whereas the upward jet is driving this flux rope or plasmoid in cross-section. And that's what eventually goes out and becomes the coronal mass ejection. So this is the what I would call the anatomy of a flare. This is how flares are built. But most of the energy is thought to be released in this region because of this inflow and the cancellation or reconnection of magnetic flux. So let's go ahead and take a look at the September 10 event, finally, and we'll match it with the model. So here's the movie, a little bit easier to see now. We're kind of zoomed in a bit. And I want to back up just a bit and show you a certain point. See right here, you can see that rising up flux rope, and we're seeing it in cross section. So there's more to it coming over here and going over here that's kind of invisible, but the middle part of that flux rope becomes visible. And as it goes up, it actually forms a void. And the reason there's a void there is not because of low density or not very much material, but this stuff here, which is bright, but relatively cool, gets hot, gets really hot. It gets so hot that it stops emitting in extreme ultraviolet. It's hotter than extreme ultraviolet would allow. So this is a really hot region that's part of that flux rope. And then you can watch that thing. It's almost like a little balloon that expands upward. And it doesn't take long. All that happens very quickly. Maybe 3 or 4 minutes across that vast region of space. And then it continues going up out of the screen. And then these other loops here are forming below. So those are the loops that we mentioned here. Those are these loops here. So this flare is just beautifully oriented on the limb to allow us to see from the side all of this happening. So there, we have a model for this, of course, which I mentioned before, but I'm just showing you now with some arrows. So these arrows are showing the direction of the magnetic field. It's coming out of this sunspot. That's a plus polarity coming over here and going into the minus polarity or the south pole of the magnet. And so the arrow is indicating the direction of the field. But you'll notice that there's another way to get over here. You can go all the way up here and go around this way and come all the way down here. And so this flux rope, which was lying between these sunspots, has risen up and carried the magnetic field with it and stretches it out. And then behind it, you'll notice that the field lines are up here and down there. So they're oppositely directed magnetic fields, and they're pushed together because of the essentially the vacuum that is created by this uprising flux rope. And so all of these field lines are now moving toward each other, and they meet at an X point where the field line actually touches. And at that point, it can reconnect and form other loops like this. So you can see that where the field line used to come up and go this way, it now connects over to this one and becomes this loop. And this one was going up here and around. It's connecting here and becoming this sort of island. And you can see that there's nothing to keep these pointy looking loops from staying up there. They're under tension. They feel like springs or rubber bands. And they simply move away from each other and form these jets moving up and down. So that's the way the magnetic field releases the energy is to annihilate parts, you know, some components of themselves and form these loops. So here's the sort of outline of what happens in a flare. A flux rope forms along a line between opposite polarity magnetic fields. The magnetic fields are sheared so that they lie along the line instead of across it. And by the way, that requires currents to flow. That kind of shearing requires the presence of currents. The flux rope erupts and drags the magnetic field out with it. And that current system all moves up and begins to dissipate. So you can think of it in terms of an interruption of a current system. Oppositely directed magnetic field moves in to fill the void, reconnects to form an outward going loop and a downward developing arcade of hot loops. And the lower loops slowly cool. Possibly some material can rain down. It's actually called coronal rain, and it rains down to the surface. And much of this process, especially the hotter non-thermal component, is largely invisible. And so that's the key thing I want to emphasize here, is that for many decades, we have pieced together this picture without really being able to see some of the important components of the thing in action. Hard X-rays and radio emission can see this high energy component. And so for decades, we've used hard X-rays. Radio emission has been lacking in terms of our ability to use it. And so I'm going to describe in a moment some of that. But this is a slide just talking about how do we see this invisible stuff. So we know that we've got this. This is now kind of a negative. So what's dark here is really very bright in extreme ultraviolet. And this is a cartoon showing this rising cavity. And the motion is, of course, outward this way. But we know that at the same time, there's some very, very high energy particles here. And so we can visualize them by looking at hard X-rays, because those high energy particles can produce X-rays. But they need to run into something in order to produce X-rays. So the way you produce X-rays is you accelerate particles and then make them hit a target of some kind. So they need to hit some atom, some ions in the atmosphere. So these color contours here represent high energy hard X-rays. This is the spatial location of high energy hard X-rays. But you'll notice that they're centered around this bright emission here, and they don't really fall much outside of it. But if you bring this down to the scale of this image, you see that all of that is just right here. So the high density part of the flare is down in these loops, and you can see the hard X-rays there. We know that there are high energy particles there, but that's all we have known for a long time. Microwaves, are sensitive to the same particles, but they only require a magnetic field in order to make themselves visible. They don't require any density. And so with our instrument, expanded Owens Valley Solar Array, for the first time, we're able to make images now of the radio emission from these high energy particles in a much larger volume. So instead of just seeing the high energy particles in this tiny volume, we see that they actually exist all the way along the axis of this cavity. They even can be seen kind of wrapping around it. This is the actual image, and then these are some contours superimposed here. But what's interesting is you also see some side sources that we didn't even know were there. So that's as a result of our instrument, the expanded Owens Valley Solar Array. And it really is a breakthrough instrument. We've been studying the design of this instrument for, you know, since the early 2000s, and finally had the opportunity to build a demonstrator of this idea. So we have 13 antennas. You know, we originally would like to build 100 of these antennas and have tremendous capability. But this, what we've done so far is to build 13 of them. But nevertheless, we've been able to use them to make images over a wide frequency range. It's a 1 to 18 gigahertz radio frequency range. And we observe at many frequencies in and observe all of that in 1 second. So we can make these images of all those frequencies in 1 second. And that allows us to do fast spatially resolved spectroscopy. And spectroscopy is really the key to making physical measurements. We're not just seeing where the emission is bright and how bright it is, but we can actually get quantitative information about the environment that the particles are in and the emitting particles themselves. So I won't say more about the instrument except to say that it's really a breakthrough instrument that allowed us to learn a lot of new information. So what I'm going to do is show you some examples of data from the instrument and then some of the analyses we've done of this particular, again, iconic flare from September 2017. So along the bottom is what we call a dynamic spectrum, and it covers 2 hours or so of time this way. So time marches on this way, and vertically is the frequency. So you can see that this line here is marking the time that is shown here. This is an early time when that little extreme ultraviolet flux rope was just poking up there. You can see already we see some radio emission from that. And then I'm just going to run the movie. This will show you where we are in terms of the spectrogram. And then you can watch here is the four different frequencies, contours of four different frequencies. And then over here will be the unadorned movie from the extreme ultraviolet. Okay. So we see the filament eruption. We see the current sheet light up. This is the current sheet up to the cavity. And then over quite a long time, we have these rising flux loops. And then at around this time, the source seems to split into two on either side of this strong, what we call a plasma sheet. And then toward the end, you can see in the spectrogram that you've got these little extra brightenings. And those are like pulsations that are occurring on one leg of the loop. They just come and go. Every time there's a pulsation, the thing brightens up and then it gets fainter again. And of course, all this time, the other loops are slowly rising. So what we're seeing is that there are a lot of high energy particles that are accelerated in this region well above this and somehow make their way down to that location. And they become visible in the radio. So I want to highlight these outlier sources that occurred very early in the event. You cannot really see the connection, but there are some connections from here up to here and down to here. So there's one loop that kind of goes up and meanders over here, and another loop that kind of goes up here. And so these right here, this where they narrow down is where they're going to reconnect. And they actually form a curlicue here in the corona and then a closed loop down here. So that blue line and that yellow line become these two lines. And so this is the flux rope. This whole thing here is the flux rope. And you can see there's a connection between this location and the remote sources. So remote sources can light up. And I've got some other plots here I'm not going to go into detail about, but these are the spectra that we can make that allow us to make measurements of the magnetic field strength and the number of particles and their energy distribution and things like that. We can also look at time profiles and see that the sources at the remote site and the main site actually brighten and get weaker together. And the very main site down here is this curve that just keeps rising. So after the flux rope is gone, then the main flare just keeps getting brighter and brighter. So we did a study of just the region connecting these loops down here and this cavity. This is the region of what we call the reconnecting current sheet. So this is the place where the reconnections are supposed to occur. And using our data, we're able to actually measure things like the magnetic field strength as a function of height. And I won't go into that much detail, but I just want to show you the plot of magnetic field strength. So if you take a cut down this way from the cavity down through this X point where the reconnection is occurring and down into the closed loops of the jet going downward, you see that there's very high field strength. This is magnetic field strength going horizontally, getting higher and higher this way. The very high field strength here, it gets to be lower just at this point, and then it rises again when we get to the X point, just a little bit of a rise, but still it's a very significant increase in magnetic field, and then it drops. And what's interesting is that these points are measurements, and these lines are the theoretical expectation from MHD theory. So we have an excellent measurement of the magnetic field along that very important part of the flare. This is where all the activity is coming from. We can also look at this main part of the flare and actually measure magnetic fields that occur in that region. So this is a magnetic field map. So every location in this source, we can make a spectrum. And for each spectrum, we can measure the magnetic field in that point. So at one moment of the flare, we can make magnetic field measurements at all these points. And then if I show you as a movie, you can watch how that magnetic field evolves over time. So this is about 4 minutes of time. And there are a lot of fluctuations that are, not all believable. There, obviously, as you go from place to place, you can have some different fits to the spectrum that are a little bit different than others. But if you watch the movie again, let me just show you again, you can watch it starts out kind of a light green and becomes a darker and darker blue. So that's an overall decrease in the magnetic field strength. And that magnetic field decrease is a sign of release of magnetic energy. So the magnetic energy that was stored there is getting dissipated. And that's in fact what drives the particle acceleration and things like that. So here's a later part of the event. I'll show you, this is a movie here again, at the time when that bifurcation happens. And you can just, these are images at many, many frequencies. And if you kind of, I'm looking at this panel, I'm just kind of superimposing this extreme ultraviolet image at the same time. You can see where that bifurcation is exactly bisected by this plasma sheet. And from that, we can get information about the temperature and density of the plasma sheet, you know, real physical measurements of the quantities. And then later on in the late phase, you remember that this flare had a big coronal mass ejection. So here's the coronal mass ejection. That plasma sheet is way down here. This is the whole sun. This is the occulting disk. And that's the huge coronal mass ejection. So if we zoom in here, we see that plasma sheet just continues on and on and on all the way out to connect to the body of the coronal mass ejection. And if we zoom in on this part, which is an even smaller region, we come down to the region of the sun where we're actually imaging with our radio emission. And there's this very thin, again, plasma sheet where the reconnection is occurring and sending particles down. And what we find is that there's some interesting pulsations down here. So it's this long, thin plasma sheet and loop top hard X-ray source, and then a radio source is in here. And those are the locations of some pulsations, those pulsations I mentioned earlier. So this is the overall kind of model for those pulsations. The idea is that you've got these plasma inflow, you get the reconnections here, and that causes little blobs of stuff, really seriously blobs of stuff coming down, and those blobs will hit the top of this these newly closed loops, and it will accelerate particles, which then shoot down into the leg, and we see those in the microwaves. And the X-rays, of course, are seen in the denser, higher areas here like this. So that's it for some of the results that we've gotten from that particular flare with our new instrument. Just like to look ahead to the next solar cycle. We do have solar cycle predictions. People try to divine from past solar cycles what the next one is going to be like. This is the projection, and it's expected that in July 2025, we will hit the maximum with a sunspot number of 115. That's, you can see these numbers here. Back in the 90s, 90 to 2000, or early 2000s, I guess, we had more like 170 sunspot numbers. So we're gonna have a much weaker one. But still, the prediction is that we're well on our way. Sometime in between 2020 and 2021, we should be definitely ramping up here. And in addition to having EOPSA, which, you know, we're excited to get some new flares because we've had such a period of essentially no flares, we're also developing another instrument called the Owens Valley Long Wavelength Array, which will be able to make images at higher heights. So, you know, in this range and even up into here. So much higher than this these low heights that the EOPSAs can image. And at the same time, there are some exciting new space missions, Parker Solar Probe, Solar Orbiter, and another one you may not have heard of called Sunrise. So the Avro LWA, this is the new radio instrument we're building in Owens Valley. This is an example of what we can do. Here's, again, the coronagraph images, and you can see a coronal magnet, coronal mass ejection that's rising up. And at the same time and location, we have these radio sources. And we've just recently published a paper about this one, describing, you know, trying to measure the magnetic field strength in this region. There's a lot of theory that depends on, you know, the details of how this is all happening. So trying to get measurements here is very important. The array will be upgraded from this version. We'll have higher spatial resolution, much higher time resolution, 10th of a second rather than 10 seconds as we had here. And it will be solar dedicated, so we'll actually get every event all the time. And we expect observations in the next 6 to 8 months from this. But in space, we have the Parker Solar Probe. This was launched about 2 years ago. And you may have heard of this. It's launched from Earth, of course, and then it is moved inward toward the sun. And due to repeated close approaches of Venus, here's the orbit of Venus, it actually loses additional energy and moves closer and closer. So up to now, the green curves, or green or yellow, is what it has done so far. And then the red are future orbits that will be where we'll get closer and closer to the sun. You can see we're well inside the orbit of Mercury, and ultimately, we'll get within 10 solar radii of the surface. Now, the thing about Parker Solar Probe is it has an imaging instrument, but it can only image to the side. It can't look at the sun. And the reason for that is because the sun is too hot. It's got this very high-tech shield that is trying to shield the atmosphere of the sun from just burning the instrument up. And so it can look ahead of its motion along its orbit and look at features moving out from the sun, but it can't look actually at the sun. But it is measuring fields and particles as a function of distance from the Earth to the sun. And there's a lot to be learned about the interplanetary medium and how that varies between the Earth and the Sun. So it's really exciting work that they're doing. They've been going now for a couple of years, but they'll be getting closer and closer in the next 5 years or so. And then we got Solar Orbiter. It also, of course, I think this is the Earth's orbit here, and so it moves in closer. It doesn't get inside the orbit of Mercury, but one of the things is that because it's farther away, it does have sun imaging instruments, so it can actually get closer to the sun, you know, almost as close as Mercury, and take some pictures close up. It can also measure magnetic fields on the surface to compare with Earth's perspective. So it's really great to have two different magnetic field maps from different perspectives, and you can get the three-dimensional magnetic field from that. It will also see the poles. It will go as much as 30 degrees out of the ecliptic, in other words, north and south of the plane of the Earth's orbit, and therefore it will be able to look down on the poles of the sun for the first time. And it has a hard X-ray imager, which is interesting to me because we like to compare our hard X-ray images with the radio ones that we get with EOPSA. So there's one other mission I want to mention, which is the Sunrise mission. This is actually a constellation of CubeSats. So there's six small CubeSats that are going to be orbiting the Earth, sort of geosynchronous height orbits. And it's going to act like an interferometer. So it's going to be similar to EOPSA's array here and make interferometric images of the sun, but it's going to do that at very low frequencies, much lower than you can see from the ground. So normally you can only see down to about 20 megahertz or so from Earth, and any lower frequency is blocked by the ionosphere. So by putting these spacecraft up above the ionosphere, you can go to lower frequencies. And this will be the first imaging interferometer for solar bursts, the first one ever. And they're going to be looking for the shock waves that come out, pushed out in front of coronal mass ejections, which of course accelerate the particles that we see and that are so dangerous, but they also produce radio emissions. So those same particles will be studied with this instrument. So that's all I have. Go ahead and open it up for questions.
All right, thanks so much, Dale. Are there any questions?
I have one. That first movie that you showed us, what was the light that was used in that?
That's multicolored because it's got several different wavelengths, but they're all extreme ultraviolet. So
okay.
So the extreme ultraviolet is the different wavelengths are coming from different temperatures. So some wavelengths will be sensitive to 500 Kelvin or so. Sorry, 500,000 Kelvin, half a million Kelvin. And that's at the low end. And at the high end, they go up to several million Kelvin or even 10 million Kelvin.
How are you able to predict future sun cycles?
Well, I cannot, but some of my colleagues can. I'll try to explain what they can do. So there are various schemes that are used. One of them actually originates from this. Where was it? Way in the front here. So this kind of migration of field to the poles, there's also some wave patterns underneath the surface that can be seen using something called helioseismology. It's basically able to look at interior waves of the sun, and those propagate differently depending on the velocity of the material underneath the surface. So this motion from lower to higher latitudes is called meridional flow. And there have been some predictions that the strength of that meridional flow kind of predicts the strength of the next solar cycle. It's early days to know if that really is reliable. There have been some who have estimated that the next solar cycle will be extremely weak or maybe even absent. And they were basing that on, I mean, you can probably see from here that the North Polar fields are very weak at this time. And so they were basing some of their speculation on the fact that this looks like a less vigorous rise to the poles. But other people are doing various kinds of predictions based on past cycles. And they have these meetings where everyone who does prediction gets together in a room, and I hate to say it, but I think they more or less average the result, which is not really a scientific thing to do, but they come up with some kind of an average that they think predicts what they'll see. And so anyway, the prediction was this one. And that is an official prediction. I mean, NASA put out a press release on it. I think it was came out of the National Oceanic and Atmospheric Administration.
I had a question related to that. The two previous solar cycles, they look like they're bimodal. I mean, is that not a normal feature, or is that something unusual?
It is seen quite often. And in fact, some of this bimodality is because maybe the northern hemisphere is dominant and then it dies away and the southern hemisphere comes up. So if you plot the dominance of the two hemispheres, they almost look like, one peak is from one hemisphere and the other peak's from another. But when you look very carefully at that, it's a rule that's made to be broken, shall we say. There's always exceptions, but indeed these kind of bimodal or double peaked maxima are kind of common.
It also looks a little asymmetric, like there's a rapid rise and a slow drop off.
Yeah, it is. There's definitely an asymmetry to it. And it's interesting that the largest flares tend to occur on the drop off. So remember that from the butterfly diagram that these early ones are relatively high latitude, and then they kind of migrate or evolve toward lower latitudes. And it's possible that those lower latitude ones somehow, they're more isolated, but they become bigger. The sunspots themselves are bigger. So there's fewer regions, but each region tends to pack more of a wall up. So you end up with bigger flares during that period. But this particular asymmetry was really quite pronounced. And that was partly because this cycle was very, very weak in the minimum. So you can see this one turned up at around the number of 10. And this one could have, but it kept going down, down, down for another 2 years. So that tends to, enhance the asymmetry. And it looks like this current solar cycle did the same thing. Very similar.
I have a question. So we're interested in these solar flares because of what they can do to Earth. Do we know what their effects is on planets like Mars and Venus at all? Do we study that at all?
Yeah, we do. There are now quite a few missions at Mars that can measure particles and fields and things like that, solar wind information. And we do get to, it's kind of nice because, of course, Mars and Earth are not necessarily aligned. So you'll have cases. Let's see, do I have Mars on here? Probably not. But Mars will be somewhere else, and then these events come out from the sun and they impact Earth in one direction, but maybe Mars at another direction, so we can kind of get a more of a latitudinal, maybe I should say longitudinal information about that. And also, if there are spacecraft out here that are intercepting some of the shock waves, et cetera, you can kind of map out things in three dimensions. And it's definitely of great interest to know, you know, more than just one point on these events. So we'd like to be able to map them out. So the Martian data are definitely used. Sometimes we can even measure changes in the Martian atmosphere due to one of these events. So, you know, Mars doesn't have a magnetic field around it like Earth does, so it's not as protected. And so some solar wind events can actually strip some of the atmosphere from Mars, certainly much more than Earth.
So going further and further, you know, through the planets, you know, away from the sun, how far do these flares go? Do they affect the outer planets as well?
That's a good question. The solar wind does. The solar wind is this ever exerted pressure on the magnetospheres of Jupiter and Saturn and Uranus. You know, all of these planets are feeling that solar wind pressure, and that solar wind pressure changes in response to some of these events going out. The extent to which an individual event affects one of those is a little bit hard to do, because you remember that spacecraft, let's say you have a spacecraft orbiting Jupiter like Galileo, it's only in one place at one time, and it's hard to know what the whole of Jupiter's magnetosphere did in response, but you can try to piece that together. And certainly, you know, there are effects. I can't really tell you that, you know, that they're unusually large or anything, but they do see effects.
Thank you.
Anybody else? Don't be shy. It's not like you'll get burned up in the sun.
No, you know, the one of the things that we actually, the Congress just passed something called the Space Weather Act. And I don't think the president signed it yet, but he's supposed to sign it shortly, I hope. And that is to try to spend more attention on the solar space weather events, because some past events like the ones I've described have been much larger than these and directed toward Earth and have caused really big events like the Carrington event in 1859. And there was a big event in 1989 that caused power outages in Quebec. And you know, if you ramp that stuff up a factor of 10 or so, it starts to become pretty scary. It can cause quite a lot of havoc to communications and power lines and things like that. So.
I have one quick question. We're going into the 25th cycle. When was the first cycle recorded? When did we start recording cycles? Was it around 1859?
So it would have been,
or was it before?
Yeah, it was before. We have cycles back even, I mean, you remember Galileo was drawing sunspots, and people from that time, you know, sunspots are hard to see without a telescope, without some kind of aid. There were some large sunspots that were noticed, you know, in Chinese history and things like that, but very rarely. But once the telescope came along, people started paying attention to the sun, and they were mapping those, you know, the comings and goings of the sunspots, and came to realize that there was a kind of a cycle to it. But then they all went away for a while. This was called the Maunder Minimum. And I don't recall now the dates, but it's a period of around 50 years in 1750 or maybe somewhat earlier. And the sunspots just went away for 50 years. And so this is called the Maunder Minimum. So we don't know that the sunspot cycles will continue or how long or whether they come and go. There's some studies of, you know, longer period cycles where they think that some, there might be like roughly three different cycles that are in interplaying with each other, sort of like biorhythms, right? So when they all add up to a peak, then you get a big maximum. And when they all kind of interfere with each other, you get a small maximum, or maybe even an extended minimum. But that's not my area of research, so I don't know the details, I have to say.
I hadn't heard biorhythms mentioned in some time.
Yeah, I guess that's a 60s thing, yeah, 70s thing.
Yeah. Any other questions? Well, Dale, thank you very much for an interesting presentation on what we don't get to look at directly unless we're the President of the United States. I've never been a big solar observer, but it's amazing when I do do solar observing and happen to stumble across sunspots and go, oh wait, I got to check these out. That's very cool. It's very
You know, I look at the sun quite often, but I had never seen a flare actually looking through a telescope until I don't know, it would have been sometime in this latest maximum, but 14 or so, I was just looking through the telescope and saw a brightening. It was with an H-alpha telescope, but it was pretty amazing. It's really exciting.
Yeah. Well, thank you. Anybody have anything for the good of the order? Because we will turn off the recording and retire to our virtual diner, our virtual Manila's Diner, which is, Dale, there's a place about 5 or 6 miles down the road from where we meet when we meet in person, where we hang out. And nobody's been hanging out there since our February meeting. So we hang out on the, you're welcome to stay with us, as I sometimes refer to it as the end of our PG rated program, but I still see we're live on YouTube until Jeremy kills that.